Good afternoon. I'm Mayor Daniel Fessler. It's my pleasure to call the Reidsville City Council meeting, this being June 13th, 3 p.m. to order. This afternoon, we have the privilege of having the Honorable David Bracken to give an invocation. Pastor Bracken.
Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to continue to serve the community and to serve one another. Lord, we thank you for the many blessings that you've bestowed upon this community, Lord. And Father, we pray that you will continue to instill in our leadership to continue to press forward, Lord, always mindful of what you have done and what you will continue to do on our behalf. Now continue to bless us all individually and collectively. For it is in thy Son's name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Chief Bracken, you'll stay there just for a second. I know the council members would like to share their congratulations with you in order. For those folks who are not aware, David just recently received his doctorate degree. So, and I made a couple of, let's give him a round of applause. So my question would be, do we refer to you as pastor, minister, chief, or doctor?
David.
David, on behalf of the council and all the people in this audience, I know we're so proud of what you do for the fire department as well as with your leadership in our community and certainly in your church. And I know that this doctorate came as a result of a lot of long, intense work. And I know that the family and the whole community supports you. We're very proud of you, as always.
Thank you so much.
Anyone else would like to say something, then you're more than happy to.
I plan on calling it Chief Doctor.
Well, Mayor, I'd just like to add how proud we are of Chief Bracken David. My gosh, he's an amazing person to be able to do all that he does and go on to get his doctorate. It's just an amazing thing. And you know, I will tell the story about David that I think I know all the department heads' phone numbers except for his. You know, when I need to call Chief Bracken, I need to look it up.
That's good.
And that's a good thing. So I appreciate everything you do for us, Chief. You're doing a great job with the fire department and just with everything else you do in your life here. It's an amazing thing that you've done. Thank you.
I feel that no one can really speak for him, so I have to speak for myself and say that I'm extremely proud. And when I heard the news, I certainly rejoiced about it. So congratulations.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Chief Bracken, we'd like to give you the honor of leading us in the Pledge of Allegiance. If you would please rise, if you're able, and join us in the Pledge of Allegiance, led by Dr. Bracken.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God,
one brief announcement. The city family is extremely in a sad mood today because one of our own police officers, Nancy Bennett, lost her mother, and some council members have been attending that funeral this afternoon and had to juggle their schedule to get here. We certainly extend to Officer Bennett our much condolences for the loss of her mother. Any other announcements before we start our council meeting? This time I'd like to recognize the Honorable Councilman Walker for the purpose of a special recognition. Councilman Walker.
Thank you. I am so honored to be before you today. We are going to recognize one of Reidsville's finest. And if you'll give me just a moment, I'm going to get set up here. It's nothing like putting me in the hot seat. And Jess, if you will come with me. All right, this time I remember to put my glasses on. I hate to be vain and say I need them, but I do. Welcome, everybody. It's a privilege to have you here. June the 13th, this is Jess Moore Day. It is an honor for me to read this certificate of appreciation. Whereas Jess Moore has lived the majority of his life in Reidsville, attending public schools and graduating from Reidsville Senior High, after representing the student body class president his freshman and sophomore years, vice president of student government his junior year, and president of the student government his senior year. And whereas Jess Moore volunteered for the U.S. Navy in 1943 and attended naval officers training at both Duke and Chapel Hill before deploying to the Pacific, being part of the intended invasion fleet of Japan and destroyer escort. And whereas Jess Moore, after returning from service in the U.S. Navy, attended Duke University, then graduated from UNC in 1947 and UNC Law School in 1950, and went on to receive his law degree April the 4th, 1951, practicing law in Raleigh and Greensboro before opening his law office in Greensboro. And whereas Jess Moore has experienced his concern for his community through his devoted service as Rockingham County School Board member and to various civic organizations, such as the Board of Directors for the YMCA, the United Way, the Salvation Army, Rockingham County Moorheads Committee, Rockingham County Young Democrats, Reidsville Rotary Club, Reidsville Elks Club, Reidsville JCs, Mason, and was president and organizer of the UNC Rams Club in Rockingham County. Whereas Jess Moore has been a loyal member of the Reidsville First United Methodist Church since 1934, and has served with offices within the church, including teaching Sunday school for the past 22 years. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the City Council of the City of Reidsville takes great pleasure in recognizing and honoring Jess Moore, and publicly expresses to him our heartfelt appreciation for his tireless and unselfish dedication to his friends, his neighbors, his community, and further wishes to wish him and his wife, Barbara, and their family much happiness and prosperity in years to come. On this day, June the 13th, 2012, and this is signed by James Festerman and all the council. Now, before your applause, this is probably not proper protocol, but I'm getting kissed. I don't think I learned that in Chapel Hill. But I do love him.
Thank you very much for this special day.
It's my pleasure.
Let me continue to add,
for, but a long time. But one of the things, Jess and I took a trip down to the Gator Bowl, and that was one of the more fun trips we've ever had. But the other thing I remember about more importantly was I was a young police officer, and he was beating me up in court, and he never looked nervous then. I said, I didn't stab you in the back, but I thought about it that way. Council, now take a 5-minute recess. So you're welcome to stay as long as you like. But we hope you enjoy the rest of the day. Ms. Moore. Council, now come back to order. The next item is approval of the consent agenda. Council will direct your attention to the consent agenda. On the consent agenda, you will find 5 items listed. If any council members desires one to be pulled apart for additional information. Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion on the consent agenda.
So moved.
Motion made with Councilman Gorham. Is that second?
Second.
Second by Councilman Walker. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please indicate to raise your right hand. And let the record reflect the carried unanimously. This afternoon, we have some public hearings. The first one will be consideration of proposed operating budget for fiscal year 2012-2013 for the ABC board. Just for the information, for your information, we will not be required to take any action on this proposed operating budget. We allow the ABC board to use this forum, since they do not have a forum to have a public hearing, they're required by law to do that. So I have a copy of the proposed ABC board budget that I just received this afternoon. If anyone has any questions, I will ask the vice chairman, Ms. Brady, the ABC board representative, she can come in. Any questions before we open up the public hearing? Any questions regarding the ABC board? I understand Denise worked all night long in preparation to answer any questions you might have. So, any questions from Ms. Brady? Hearing none, we'll now open the public hearing. The public hearing is now open for the purpose of discussing the operating board, operating budget for the fiscal year 2012-2013 of the ABC board. Public hearing is now open, this being 3:20. Anyone who'd like to speak in favor or against the proposed budget? Seeing anyone, neither one appearing, we will now close the public hearing at 3:21. The public hearing is now closed. We will need to take no action, so go forth.
We've been over with a fine-tooth comb.
Thank you.
I've been told this is the only copy, so I'm going to give it back to you right now. Thank you, Ms. Brady, thank you for your service to the ABC board.
Thank you.
No, the next one is consideration of proposed operating budget for fiscal year 2012-2013 for the city of Reidsville. We have several members of the finance team and city manager, so I'll start with you, Sam.
Thank you, Mayor. I'll just give a presentation on behalf of the staff. As your city manager, I also serve, one of the capacities I also serve in is as your budget officer. And in that capacity, I'm pleased to submit to you a balanced operating budget for fiscal year 2012-2013. As you know, we've had several work sessions in preparation for this budget. I'd like to report that the budget was prepared in accordance with the North Carolina Local Government Budget and Fiscal Control Act. We've advertised this public hearing at least 10 days prior to this hearing. We've had copies that were available for the public viewing in both the city clerk's office and the Reidsville Public Library. And our budgets continue to be conservative, and as we have been in past years, we are often new services where we believe in any recommending any deletion services. These are continue to be over line budgets that we bring to City Council. However, I will report for the first time in several years, we are seeing some uptick in revenues, slight upticks in, for example, the ad valorem taxes. We're seeing a slight increase due mainly to the increase in the tax base in the community. For the first time since I think 2008-2009, we're anticipating an increase in sales tax. This last several years, and the sales tax is a major source of revenues for the city. The last several years, we've seen decreases in the sales tax. And this year, for the first time, we've seen some increases in this fiscal year, and we're anticipating, and we get this information from our league offices, that we're expecting to see some increases in the sales taxes. We have reduced the number of employees that were being shown in this budget. Last year, we had reported 177 full-time employees. This year, we have reduced that number to 175. Revenue projections, you know, on the surface, even though I'm telling you that when I report to you that we anticipate that revenues will go up, when you look at the budget figures, the revenue projections will actually show a projected decrease of minus 8.75% for the general fund and minus 16.69% for the Parks and Recreation Fund. And we have to present it to you that way because those are the actual dollars. When compared to last year's revenues, it shows a downturn, mainly because last year's amended budget, the revenues for the amended budget also will reflect the budget transfers that we did throughout the year, grants that were received throughout the year. You know, we haven't received any grants. We don't receive the grants until the beginning of the year. So technically, when we look at projections at the beginning, we are showing a decrease in revenues, but that's pretty much on paper. We are still anticipating in real cash dollars an increase in revenues. Regarding capital, you know, we started off the whole budgeting process in December when I asked the department heads to submit requests for over the next five years. And when we looked at those capital requests, I was really looking for those types of capital requests or either equipment or improvements that could not be put off without a disruption of some type of service, some type of services that we were providing. I did not see any. Except for some minor computer replacements, planned replacements. So this budget does not have any capital improvements at this point. However, once we get by the end of this fiscal year and we see what kind of financial shape, I may take the opportunity to go over those requests again and see if there are some that, yeah, we could put off, but maybe we should go ahead and address them now. Maybe, and I'll ask the assistant city manager, Chris Phillips, to work with me on a financing plan to make sure that we're getting the biggest bang for our buck. So there's that possibility in the future months that I might be bringing some of those capital requests back to you. Once we see, after we close out FY 11-12, see what kind of financial condition we're in. The challenges we have before you, you know, I think I started this in last year's budget, my budget message to City Council last year outlined some of the challenges that we have before us. This year, some of our major challenges will be addressing the senior center, locating a place, a site for a new senior center. I think that everybody on board, you've already given your consensus that you do not wish the senior center to be relocated back in the basement of the gym facility on Franklin Street. So we will be looking for a new site. We'll be looking for to establish a plan and also the financing for a new senior center. So that'll be one of the major challenges we have before us this year. We'll be completing the spillway. That's already in construction, as you know. And they're making great headway on that project. Hopefully within the next fiscal year, we'll be able to complete that project and be able to fill the lake back up to its normal levels. Water treatment plant, I've discussed with you at length the water treatment plant, some of the improvements that need to be made out there to bring it up to date and make it as efficient as possible. Will be preliminary engineering is already underway on that. We've already contracted with Camp Dresser at McGee, CDM Incorporated, to start the preliminary engineering on the water treatment plant, and we'll be bringing to you later in the year final plans for discussion to see when we want to go forward with going forward with those improvements to the water treatment plant. Wastewater treatment plant is basically the same message. We know that there's serious updates that need to be done out there at our wastewater treatment plant to make sure that we never have any disruption in service. But not only that, but we can continue to make meet state and federal guidelines and regulations on that. And we need to continually reinvest in the wastewater treatment plan. And I've discussed with you at a great length at a work session about some of those improvements. And so we, as you said, as with the water treatment plant, we've already started the preliminary engineering. That's underway, and we'll be bringing back to you sometime in this during this fiscal year plans for final design and the financial plan as to how we move forward with those improvements. Water and sewer distribution system is another big challenge. We've addressed the need to we'll discuss the need to continually start planned replacement of water lines and sewer lines, the line water and sewer lines in the city to make them work more efficiently. One of the major problems we have with discolored water is with when we flush the water lines, the buildup of materials in our water lines causes a temporary discoloring in the water. So we've looked into a unidirectional flushing program that we've just been doing some testing on, and I'll be bringing back that in the next, we've discussed this in before, but I'll have some recommendations on that in the very near future as far as going forward with that. Rethinking government, that's a continuing theme of my administration as city manager, to keep thinking about ways we can produce services more effectively and efficiently for to try to keep their costs down for the citizens of Reidsville. As we lose key positions, or we see that key positions, people are aging out, we're going to continually look to see how we can reorganize to make our service delivery of service more effective. The 911 emergency call system. As you know, last year at this time, we were facing, you know, what were we going to do? How we needed to merge our system with Eden and Rockingham County. And thankfully, we were able to come to agreements on that and receive a $7.826 million grant from the state to help us with that merger. And that'll be a continuing challenge until all those things start to happen and all the plans are made and the designs are done for creating the new building and the new service out of Wentworth. Employee wellness is something that we're going to continue with. We started last year, and we're going to hit it full force this year on our wellness program to try to keep our costs down, to not only have healthier and happier employees, but also to reduce our costs for our insurance when we can, and also reduce the amount of sick leave that people have to take. So that's something that we're going to continue to do. And just like last year, this budget includes a contingency line item in my budget for any possible rate increase in gas prices. You know, that's one of those great unknowns that are out there. You hear when the gas prices spike, everybody says, well, it's going to go to $5 or $6. Well, we put a contingency line item to allow me to address that just in case the worst scenario happens and we do have to give some extra money to the departments to meet their needs.
What was the amount that you put in the contingency for that?
I think it was $30,000.
And that was based on gas being what price now?
That was based upon, I think we did an average of, we did an average of our worst case scenario over the last 4 years to arrive at what we should give the departments in their line items. And the $30,000 was just a cushion above and beyond that. This budget does include a 3% cost of living increase for our full-time employees, and this is the first increase we've had in the last 3 years. We gave a cash bonus, one-time cash bonus of $750 last year, but this 3% cost of living increase goes to all full-time employees and will make not be just a one-time payment, but will continue to pay as they go forward. So I'm very grateful to the City Council for giving me that direction to try to find that money to get this increase. There is an increase in this budget for the city side of the health care premiums that are paid by the city for the full-time employees and retirees so that we can reduce that liability of our self-insured insurance plan. This budget also includes money to do a minimum implementation of our pay plan and classification study so that all employees, what we did was we had a consultant look at all the positions that we have and reclassify them to make sure that we could be competitive with our peer groups in the state, and particularly in the local area, so that we don't lose employees to other cities just because they can make a dollar or two more. What we did was we provided enough money in there so that we made sure that all employees will be at least at their bottom rung of their new pay range. So this is a minimum implementation, but it does keep us competitive. And again, I appreciate the support of City Council for that action. The bottom line is that the projected tax levy for this year is $7.4 million. The tax rate stays the same at 0.71 cents per hundred. Evaluation. There are no increase in the tipping fees, and there's no change in the water and sewer rates. I have before for your approval a resolution of understandings that will accompany the budget that kind of outlines all the conversations that we've had. I also have before you a budget ordinance that will adopt this budget that's before you today. I'd like to thank particularly the Illinois City Council for the support and the attention that you gave to me throughout this process, but also to Assistant City Manager Chris Phillips and to our Director of Human Resources, Terry Stanley. They've been through this a lot more times than I have, and I continue to lean on them heavily, and they are just very good at what they do. So with that, that's my presentation. I have any questions.
Any questions, City Manager? Ed, you got a question? I just got a comment, and yes, I looked through it, I guess in right much detail, but one of the things that always struck me is the fact that there's no capital in that, and I don't think it's being realistic that we can participate. And you talked about this in your budget message, of course, that we would have to, I'd prefer that capital been projected because I think that's the way I thought to do my business. But another thing I'm going to ask you about, and I can do this with every budget, but this is one I just happened to flip through this a second ago, the IT budget. Now, I've been told since I was on council that we always had to anticipate every year that we'd have to put money in the capital in the IT department. That would always be something. Computers have to be updated.
That's
right. I saw the department head requested $206,000, and we didn't do it any. And I don't know what that was for. You know what that was for?
That was for some of that was for actually for our voicemail system, for our phone system. Was a great majority of that. There are, what we've done, instead of concentrating those types of replacements for computers in that IT budget, is scattered throughout. You'll see in the different budgets that there are line items for computer replacements, planned replacements of computers throughout the budget. So
they're actually there, they're just not in that?
In that IT budget.
So that answered that question. Any other questions? City Manager. Hearing none, we'll now open up the public hearing. The public hearing is now open, this being 1:35. Anyone who would like to speak in favor of the proposed budget, please come forward. If you'd like to speak in favor of it. If you'd like to speak against it, please come forward. Seeing none, we will now close the public hearing at 3:36. I'd ask you, Mr. Manager, is anyone, if you hadn't called anyone with any concerns, grave concerns regarding the budget, the process? Not the process, but the items in the budget.
No, except for some discussions I've had among City Council.
Nobody. Okay. For those folks in the audience who may not be aware, I think most of you probably are, this budget has been on display at the library for the last month.
Yeah, the last 2 weeks.
Last 2 weeks, so. We hope the citizens would have an interest in opportunity to see that. Okay, now we'll entertain a motion regarding the resolution. I'm sorry, the operating budget. All those in favor?
Before we go with the motion, I do have a concern with the budget. I think in our police department that we have sort of a crisis situation there. Especially on the patrol level, there's not a presence of minorities on the patrol level. And I think that that in itself is a crisis. And what I would like to see is that, because it happened for me, and that's why I was able to be a police officer And it meant a lot to me. And I know over the years it's been done, and it's been a great help in getting more minorities into the police department. But I would like to see if the city manager could look into our general fund this year and see if there is money that we could transfer over to the police administration. It costs about $17,000 per person. That pays for the BLET uniform, the training, give them a salary as well, minimal salary while they're attending the basic law enforcement training. And I would like to see two positions granted, which would be about $34,000. But I think it would be a great benefit to the city, and I think it would pay off in a great way in the long run.
What I would recommend, if that would be the council to change his budget, that's not a problem. It's not a problem to do it right now. It becomes more complicated once you adopt it, and we amend the budget from time to time. But now you could just ask me to put $35,000 in the police administration for BLE training program for new hires. So that as positions open up, we could have potentially some minorities replace those positions. I know we do have some people that are going to be retiring this year. What I would further recommend is we would change the revenue line item because we have to balance the budget. If you have an additional expense, you have to have additional revenue on the other side of the budget. And I would just say to transfer, just put a transfer in there from the general fund balance to offset for the revenues to pay for that line item.
What would be the proposed salary for this training? I guess you call them the trainees, is that what you call them?
Yes, sir.
What would be the proposed starting salary?
It would be about around $17,000 total for that employee to be uniformed, to buy the gun, to go through all the training.
But what was the salary? My question is,
would include the salary.
Well, the salary is the past. What we've done is, in the past, what we've done is bring in somebody at two levels below
the beginning
pay range. If they get through the training, and once they become a sworn officer, then they jump up two ranges to the beginning level.
So you propose to have a contract with these people?
Oh, yes.
Do you have a copy of the contract this afternoon?
Yes, there's a contract available, but not this afternoon. I don't have it.
I can produce a copy. We've had a standard contract. We've done this, I think, since Chief Hunt has been police chief. I think he said that about six patrol people have gone through.
That's
there.
True.
And we started using a contract that was developed specifically for the city of Reidsville that requires them to work 2 years. If they don't work those 2 years, then they have to pay us back. Now, I think the contract isn't what makes the program effective, though. It's finding the right people is what makes them effective, and giving the chief the time and the ability to find the right people. And we'll take recommendations from the public as to who good candidates would be, but having the chief, like he would any sworn officer, look to make sure that they are the right quality people that we want on our police force prior to putting them into this program. That's the key, is making sure you have the right people right from the beginning. But we would have a contract that would provide for them paying them back if they don't work for us for 2 years.
What has been our retention status with the program? Do you have any idea?
I can tell you, during the time that I worked in patrol, we still have three or four officers working now that went through that program. And we only had one that I know of, out of seven, yes, that we had. It was a contract matter. Was one of
and did we collect from that one? Did we get our money back from that one?
No, we did not. But yeah, as I said, so it's, I don't know, the contract is something that serves to try to get that recognition from both sides of the agreement that's being made. And it's very difficult to enforce those contracts after they've worked for a specific period of time for us. It is difficult to collect that money. The contract that we have now is probably more enforceable than it used to be, but it's still always going to be difficult. He's always going to be finding the right person.
It's all been debated in law enforcement managers discussion. How valuable is a contract anyway? If you've got someone working for you, he's there only because of contractual obligation. It's probably not a very good employee anyway. You probably got difficult anyway. So, a lot of departments have contractual agreements will walk away just because. But and of course you look at it too. It has to be prorated too. It can't be, you know, all or nothing. You have to work a certain time. It has to have that in the contract. I've seen a lot of them. Some of them are good and some of them not so good.
I see this has been a really good instrument for recruiting minorities because they'll have some form of a salary while they're going through the process. And we seem to have a problem recruiting minorities to the police department in Reidsville. And this would be something where we could take our time, like Mike said, and get a quality person. And hopefully that person will be able to, you know, stay on through the contract. And at present, we will have one minority on patrol, and it doesn't reflect the population of Reidsville.
Are these recruits, are they people who already work for the city and are transferred in, or people from folks from the outside?
We often hear that minorities, in many cases, do not have the family support or the wherewithal to attend BLE dealing process. Historically, what we've got to do in Reidsville is hire people who have already been completed the BLET, the Basic Law Enforcement Training Program. That handicaps a certain part of our segment of our community because they don't have the wherewithal to go to school. And this is, I think this is what
they have a job.
That's been part of the problem, is being able to have a job and attend the training at the same time. This gives them the opportunity to be employed at the end.
One of the real problems you have is, it's not that you can't be handled, but the program is offered on a full-time basis or a part-time basis. It costs us a lot less money if we send somebody to school on a full-time basis because it doesn't string it out so long.
Yes, sir, that's right.
So that if you couldn't get anybody in the next BLET course,
the next coming up is a full-time. And it takes full time, it takes 4 months, part time, it would take 6 months to complete.
So you'd actually have 2 extra months of salary before you. What we need to do now is open it up for him to make a motion. I don't know exactly what the council needs to do.
I would think that it might be appropriate for you to just to make a motion to change this the budget that we have before you, and then you can go forward with the resolution and the budget ordinance.
We have 175 employees, and this would allow us to have 177. Is that right?
Potentially. I mean, there might be a situation where there would be a slight overhire from time to time, depending upon the timing of somebody leading us and somebody coming on when they complete the training. You know, what we would do is if somebody from the police department retired and we knew that we already had somebody hired that's going through the BLET training, we would hold that position open until they finished. Or if they finished before somebody's retired, we would have a slight overhire situation, but we would always get back to our 175 eventually.
So it puts us in the catbird seat.
I guess that'd be less nice, but I'm not sure I feel really comfortable speaking only to minorities. If there's other deserving people out there that need to go, I don't know why we couldn't.
I don't think that we can legally say it's going to be strictly
for minorities.
I mean, this is a training program that's been used, and we've been used successfully to recruit minorities. That's the way I would.
But we can't make it exclusive for minorities.
No, it's a training program that's available to people.
people for this purpose.
Time out for a second. I realize we don't have a city attorney.
I'm sorry. The city attorney isn't here today, Mayor. He's.
I'm going to call him. Okay, you're the city attorney.
I am right now.
Councilman Harris, you went through this program yourself?
That's correct.
Okay.
Yeah. Just chief at the time.
Oh, okay.
Put through the program.
Yeah, I relate something personal. He and I were working out at the YMCA. He was working at the cotton mill.
That's right.
Cotton mill, and he told me he wanted to go to school, wanted to be a police officer, but he couldn't. He had a family, and he had a family to do the board.
That's right.
That was a first one, too.
That's right.
Sometimes you win, sometimes you lose.
And city manager, we are having people from the police department probably retiring.
Yes, we do. We know. That's something that, people, we know they're eligible, they keep bragging about it, they're going to retire, but you can't force people to retire. So, now, you assume that they're going to retire when they tell you they are. That's all I can say to that.
Okay.
It's projected here. In fact, we've actually projected to have money in our separation allowance, anticipating that we're going to have some policemen retire. So.
I can understand the mayor's concern in reference to setting aside funds just for minorities. So could we just say that we have a training program that's going to be offered to any and everybody, male, female, black, white, and it could also be used as a tool to recruit minorities because of the situation that would be available. Not necessarily the fact that we're going to hire just minorities, but it would be open to everyone. But it's also a useful tool because that person who might not be able to afford to go to school and own would have an opportunity.
Yeah, I think a minority, and I think that I think I've got the right word, but the underreported employee, I'm talking about female, what's the word that they use for the female, because when they have children, they can't go to school, so they need assistance too. Underreported. Underrepresented.
Well, we can add all that in.
I think we just make it open.
That's what I said.
Yeah, make it open. So I'm going to entertain a motion. Are you prepared to make a motion?
Yes, sir. I made a motion.
Motion's in order. Right. You need a motion.
Yes. To include. I think you would want to make a motion, Councilman, to place $35,000, just round it off to $35,000 in a line item for BLE training program in the police administration budget, and to offset those expenditures with a slight amount of revenues from the balance from the fund balance.
That's my motion, what you just said.
All the goals in the wind.
That's right.
You got it. Okay, the motion was made by second by
Johnson.
Councilman Jeff Johnson. Any further discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please indicate by raising your right hand. Passing that. Next item is item number 8. Consideration of adoption of the budget ordinance for fiscal year 2012 and 2013 and the resolution of understanding the company's budget behind closure 1.
So moved.
Let me ask a question. Hold on a second. Is the motion made by Councilman Turner? Is there a second?
No, sir.
Second. Four. Motion made and second. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. I can't believe y'all have spent $20 million on their questions. Consideration of the closing of the North, next item number 9. Consideration of the closing of the North Carolina Street Fire Department, item 32.
Mayor, I'll just make a brief report on that, and that is, the project's done. It's necessary to close out the capital project ordinance, and to transfer some final funding to make sure that everything balanced out at the end,
where there were some improvements that were made that should have come from the water fund. Some of those change orders that were done out there, the water fund, the sewer fund, and some transfer from the general fund was necessary to balance this project out. This capital project ordinance just closes that project out.
This is one great question on page two, section two. You got right-of-way acquisition, and it's got it in brackets. I just wonder why it'd be in brackets. I know what brackets normally mean, but that's not in brackets.
Yeah, it was just less money than that right-of-way acquisition just was less money than we anticipated. Actually,
is there a motion regarding the Northfield 3 pilot course?
I so move that we close that project.
I'm trying to make a motion this second.
I'll
second. Councilman Walker, second. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please indicate the raise your right hand. Motion carries unanimous. This item number 10, consideration of proposed for lease purchase vehicles as recommended by the finance officer. That's going to be you.
I'll make it. Chris is here in case I mess up, but I'll make a brief report on that, Mayor. Last year's budget, you approved the two large items, a mowing tractor for the street department and a refuse trailer for the solid waste. This just provides the financing for those. These are bigger items than usual. We can make our dollars stretch out a little more by financing them over. I think this is a four-year period, and it's a good interest rate of 1.79%, and we're doing this through BB&T. So this is just recognizing financing something that you've already approved this time last year.
This is not a part of the budget.
It doesn't require any motion for the purchase of these, but for the resolution to accept the financing, it does.
Is there a motion to accept the financing of this project?
I
need the mayor pro tem. Is there a second?
Yes, sir.
Councilman Gore. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please indicate the raise your right hand. Item number 11 is consideration of minimum housing code violation and accompanying back orders amendment. Behind the closure before, we will be dealing with three pieces of property today. The first proposal will be 8A321 South Frank Street. Board, that is that council?
Good afternoon. I'm asking for permission to close the board 321 South Branch Street. Staff received complaints which resulted in, of course, the minimum housing code inspection where we found enough violations that we held actually a hearing on the property. The title search found the property owner to be Lorraine Carpenter, and her property is being taken care of by a renter, Brenda Cardwell. There were no liens on the property. The complaint and notice of hearing was sent to the property owner through certified mail. It was also posted and ran in our local newspaper. No one attended the hearing that was held in September 2011. Following that, we mailed out an order in the same manner through certified mail, posting, and running it in the newspaper. This order gave the property owner until December 28, 2011 to close and to board up the dwelling. The reason it was to close and board is because the repair costs did not exceed 50% of the value of the house. The value of the house for the tax records was $30,700, and we had estimated that the repair cost would be $12,000. We have found that there are property taxes owed in the amount of $4,500, and we do have liens against the property based for high grass or nuisance abatement in the amount of $2,200. The house is unoccupied. The water has been disconnected since April 2004. I do have pictures, the ordinance, and the original inspection within your package. We do estimate that closing and boarding up the house will cost around $800. Now, I am asking permission for the ordinance to be adopted. However, Reverend Cardwell has made contact with me just before council meeting and said that she hopes she has made arrangements to have this house boarded up. She said the weekend of the 24th. So I would ask if council would pass the ordinance, but then allow staff or stay it until July 1 to give the property owner or the person taking care of the property time to get it boarded up so that we do not have to allocate that money. I would want to allocate that money, but we may not have to spend that money to do it. So I will later on in my presentation ask for a budget amendment that will cover the cost for the boarding and then their demolition, that we'll speak of shortly.
Any questions? I would make a motion that we order that the property be boarded up according to the request, and the execution be stayed until what day?
I just said July 1.
Until July 1. Mm-hmm. That's my motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Second, Council Attorney. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Carry your name. Please proceed.
And also asking permission to cause the demolition of 1631 Witherspoon Drive.
Correction, 1637.
I apologize. Yes, 1637 Witherspoon Lane. Excuse me. This property we received through complaints to the police department and the neighborhood. We found the property owner to be Ruth Barnett, and with her property being taken care of, or her mailings going to a Michael Dennis. We did not find any lien holder. The complaint and notice of hearing was also mailed out by certified mail, posted, and ran in a local newspaper. No one attended the January 2012 hearing that we had, and then it was, of course, followed by an order being mailed out in the same manner. The order gave 90 days for the property owner to demolish the house, which expired on May 7, 2012. It was sent out to demolish due to the repairs exceeding 50% of the value of the house. The house is valued per the tax records at $49,800, and we have estimated that the repairs would be $40,000. We have found that the property taxes are owed on an amount of $4,200. For the years 2006 through 2009, 2010 and 11 taxes have been paid. And there is a $20.40 lien against the house due to a previous 2009 case that we had for the same very house. We brought it before council, but there was a property owner, I believe it was Mr. Dennis, who came and asked if he could board up. So council allowed that at the time instead of going forward with an ordinance. So we are estimating that $9,000 will take care of removing the asbestos and demolishing the dwelling. I would ask for approval to proceed to demolish.
Is that a question? I got a question that, well, a couple of them really. You don't have any interior shots. I guess that's because we couldn't get in. Is that the reason?
We did not go in. As you can see, this entire garage area has fallen in, and we felt best that we do not enter the house. However, I don't know if you can see very well from this picture, but there is significant roof deterioration also. So our inspectors are, of course, experienced, and they do feel that there is water damage, water definitely getting within inside this dwelling.
I guess we're setting my question is, why did we let it get this bad? I mean, Captain and I both are familiar with the broken window effect, and this is a neighborhood that, why did we let it get this far along? This looks horrible.
Well, we did, you know, start it as a deterioration. We started as a deteriorated issue in 2009. Since there was no ordinance, we were not able to bring it back after 6 months. and we had to wait until we started getting additional complaints, which is what happened in this case. And once the complaints started coming on, we got on it immediately.
If we do the boarding up, that starts a clock ticking. So we can bring it back within 6 months. The property owner boards it up. It's kind of like a, you know, it puts us up in a different thing altogether. So that was a slight glitch in this one. And you're right. It's a shame we had to get to this point before it got back.
That's a nice neighborhood. I mean, and those things can just sour a whole neighborhood. Somebody riding through looking to buy a piece of property and see this, they're not going to slow down, I'm thinking. So.
Well, again, the shame of this thing is that if you look at it, it should be a sturdy brick home. Somebody would have given the minimum of maintenance anyhow. Should never get to these points.
Thank you. What's your council pleasure regarding 1637 Withersea Lane?
So moved.
Motion made by Councilman Gorham. Is there a second?
Second.
Second Mayor Pro Tem. Any further questions? All those in favor, please indicate. Raise your right hand. Pass it now. Last but not least, 708 Reed Street.
Sorry, I sound a little bit like a repeat record, but however, I am on.
Price went up.
The house is bigger. I am asking for to cause the demolition of 708 Reed Street. We again received the complaints from the community watch group, which resulted in a minimum housing code inspection, and then of course a hearing being scheduled. We found the property owner to be Dave Henderson from Greensboro. There were no lien holders found through our title search. The complaint and notice was sent, of course, through certified mail, posted, and ran in the Reidsville Review. There was no one who attended the hearing that was scheduled for September 2011. This, of course, followed the order being mailed out for the house to be demolished. The property owner had until December 16th, 2011 to demolish the dwelling. We found that the repair costs, of course, exceeded 50% of the value. The value of the house, $48,800, and we had estimated the cost of repair would be $25,000. However, the roof on this house has been peeled back. If you will see from the pictures, we had estimated $25,000. We are estimating that it would be much more now due to the weather that has been allowed to get within this dwelling. We have found the taxes owed in the amount of $816, and there is a lien on the property for $564. That is for unpaid privilege license for renting the property, graffiti removal, and also high grass abatement. The water has been disconnected since December 2005, and it is unoccupied. We have estimated that the asbestos removal and demolition will cost $12,000. This is a rather large dwelling.
Thank you. Any questions, Ms. Sutton? What's the council's pleasure regarding 708 Reed Street? I make the motion that we authorize the demolition of 708 Reed Street. Is there a second?
Second.
Second to Councilman Harris. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please indicate by raising the right hand. Pass your unanimous. Thank you. One more.
I'm sorry. Under tab C, the very last two pages over tab C, you will find a budget amendment request. A little change here. I'm going to, Mr. Pierce's request, I'm going to hopefully be including then in the package when I present them to you. So I am requesting a budget amendment in the amount of $21,800. This will cover the cost of closing and boarding 321 South Branch, the asbestos and removal and demolition of 1637 Withersea and 706 Reed Street. And these funds would come from the undesignated fund balance.
Thank you. Any questions, Mr. Sutton? Entertain a motion regarding budget ordinance amendment number 24. Is that a move? Councilman Turner, this second.
Sir.
Second, Councilman Gorham.
Can I ask one question to it before we do this?
Sure.
Are we kind of behind on demolition?
We are trying to catch up. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Coming at us fast and furious.
Yes, sir.
Unfortunately.
Any other questions? we use outside contractors. I think that's what slows us up here most times. No, we don't do it in-house.
No, we do not do this in-house. It is a little bit of a slower process than we would prefer, but we have to do asbestos removal, and then the house has to sit for a certain period of time to get the state to come in and do a spot inspection if they want to do it. And then which we've never had them do, but after that period of time, then we can release it to the contractors to be ready to remove them. So
there's two separate contractors we have to work with, the asbestos contractor then the removal contractor.
That helps me in dealing with people at home.
We've got a motion and a second now. All those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously. Thank you, ma'am. Didn't mean to cut you short. Next item is the consideration of board and commission appointments behind the enclosure five. Today we have one applicant for the position to serve on the Regional Human Relations Commission. You did such a good job with the Jess Moore presentation. You earned the right to make the first comment. I'm skipping over the public comment, but I'd like to go ahead and give the council member a chance to make that report.
Well, thank you very much, Mayor. No matter how many times you do this, you still get nervous, but I'm learning, and I like the kissy part. I had a chance last Friday to go out and take a look with Kevin Eason at the spillway, and it was something to behold. The city manager might have to quote to tell me about this. Is it 3 acres that used to be 3 acres of concrete?
Yes, it used to be 3 acres.
3 acres of concrete, great big huge piles of concrete, and it's my understanding that they are going to take that and bust it up, so we should not need to about purchase gravel or rock for a pretty good while. I love to see the savings of our tax dollars, of our citizens' tax dollars. I got to tour the plant there, learned about filtration systems and all that stuff, and it made me kind of sick to go home because the plant's a whole lot cleaner than my house. But it was a very, very, they run a good show out there, and I appreciate Mr. Eason's time with me. Also, in the last month, as usual, Chamber of Commerce, we have had ribbon cuttings. They are working very, very hard for our city. Diane Sawyers is here, and we've had several ribbon cuttings that you have attended lately. We have another one coming up on the 19th. And if you don't mind, Diane, would you tell us a little bit about that, please?
We are happy to welcome Health Source Chiropractic and Therapy. They are based out of Greensboro. They have Greensboro, High Point, and Danville, I believe. And now they have located in Greensboro. Dr. Dan Bennett, he is a really nice fellow. He's from up north, grew up in a small town in Pennsylvania, and then did his chiropractic school in Florida and wanted to relocate back to a small town. So he's very excited. I've actually seen him and his wife and their child out at some of the downtown events. So we're really happy to have him here. They're a really good addition for Reidsville. That is next Tuesday at 9 a.m. will be the ribbon cutting. They're going to have some refreshments and sort of their grand opening. I think they're going to offer free screenings and alignments and that sort of thing. So if you would like to join us for that. Also, just to mention a couple more things, I think you all are familiar with our annual ice cream social that's coming up. on July 12th, and we will personally extend the chain of permission, a personal invitation by EMS and police. So that is going to actually be, it's normally at the announcement, Sagebrush wanted to sponsor it, so we're going to have it at Sagebrush. But I don't know, if you make homemade ice cream, you know, we always, can always welcome people and their special recipes, so if anybody would like to do that, we welcome people making homemade ice cream.
And what time is that?
I believe it's 5:30. Is that right? 5:30.
You said 12, is that correct?
It's Thursday, July 12th. And then also, just something that you might want to think about, Tuesday, July 24th is going to be a countywide chamber coffee at Rockingham County Schools. They wanted to host it, and that was the only time that we could really come up with. So if you're going to be around, that's a Tuesday, I believe, and it's going to be at the central office. And then the only other thing that I have is the chamber is planning a pancake breakfast on that Thursday. That's how I know it's Tuesday. It's Thursday is the 26th, and at Sagebrush from 6 a.m. to 9 a.m. on Thursday, July 26th, we're going to have a pancake breakfast at $5, and it is dine in or carry out. So we welcome all of you to come and attend or help serve if you'd like to. So we're going to try to knock out this living room. So all the proceeds are going to that. I think that's all I have. We have a few more room events, but they're not confirmed, so I don't want to tell you.
What are the proceeds going to?
Later in May.
Later.
Oh, okay.
Trying to knock out this last part. I'm hoping
it's starts at 6 o'clock.
6 a.m. We will be there. So.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And well, as usual, you know, please support these new businesses and families. They need our support.
Captain Turner.
No report.
Captain Johnson.
No report.
Mayor Pro Tem. Mayor has no report. Councilman Harrison.
Oh. Last night we had Parks and Recreation meeting, and there were several things discussed. Talked about the senior citizens center and the possibilities of a new facility. We talked about the 4th of July celebration, which is going to be July 3rd, starting at 4 o'clock this time rather than earlier in the day. Fireworks will start at 10 o'clock. And one of the biggest things we talked about last night was a look at the fishery at both lakes, Lake Hunt and Lake Reidsville. We're in above average range as far as our fish population, but we need to catch and keep some fish because we've got an overpopulation of crappie. I didn't realize we had people who were fishing and throwing the fish back that much, but I guess we do. So we need to have some fish when we go out and catch and keep.
Is
that it,
sir?
Is it?
Well, at first I was very concerned that we that the city could not have a summer youth camp, and it looked kind of scary there for a minute, but kudos to the Parks and Recreation Department, Teen Center, and stepping up and having something for the youth and I think that's going to help a great deal. So we certainly want to let the Recreation Department know that we really appreciate what you've done. And also the city employees luncheon, as always, nice and good to meet with all the city employees. It's a very nice social thing. And also last Saturday, I attended Jerusalem United Holiness Church on Prince William Street. They had an event entitled The King's Table. We should have given away free clothing, also food to the needy. They had gospel music, and they were there all day. And it was a very nice turnout. Councilwoman Walker and I attended, and it was very nice. I think it helped a lot of people in the community. Also, I thought it was very nice Shay Anderson being recognized in her retirement from the telecommunication duties at the police department. So we were very glad to be able to participate in that. And lastly, the 4-H, the 4-H Center, they held a week program, robotics. And there was 48 students, and some of the students were from Reidsville, had great attendance, and they learned the basic skills of engineering to sort of get their minds on the track of engineering and upcoming technology and whatnot. I thought that was very good. So, and that's all.
Yeah, there's one other thing I'd like to mention. There was something tabled last night at the Parks and Recs meeting for this year, and I think it's going to be a very good program for the youth. And Reverend Watkins is here, and he's going to be in charge of that. I was wondering if he might want to give us a little bit of what's going to happen next year, hopefully at this time, with the Moonlight Madness basketball. Just a brief, something brief.
I'm going to stand forth, and I'm going to speak now.
A preacher never misses a game.
No.
He heard of this. What we do. But last year, after being at the gym a lot, I saw that there was a need of some structural program, some program disruption. The midnight basketball came to mind. And I came out and talked with Chief Hunt, and we decided that we need these kids to come and play basketball under some structure, not just come and pick up. On the team concept, by 11 o'clock, we'd be finished, 11:30, and they would be so tired that they'd be able to go home and not run the street. It's been very effective in some other cities that's larger than Reidsville. Well, when it started, I didn't realize the effect it was going to have. The community now has gotten behind me, and now they want to start early. They want to come and have gospel singing, and they want to turn it into more than just a basketball league. They want to turn it into a community event. And I thought that was wonderful once the community got behind me and started saying, well, can we do this? Can we come? And everybody is asking to come and do this free. And I'm like, well, if you're coming to do it free, I have no problem with that. Until every week that we scheduled to play, on Friday night, we have scheduled people to come in and speak to these youth. Harry Brown is going to come and do a speaking on bullying and how to dress as a young man. The next week, we're going to have Officer Carter. She's going to come in and talk about gang prevention. The third week, Councilman Harrison and Daniel Euro gonna come in and they're gonna speak on crap.
Walkway just say no.
Drugs, that's right. Walkway just said drugs. I don't have my proposal in front of me. The next week, Jason Rolfe is gonna come and he's gonna explain to these young people law and order, basic of what laws and how laws have changed. And the next week, we're gonna have the leadership. Portia Parrish gonna bring her group in and going to speak on leadership in the community. And the final week, we're going to bring in the lady from the health department that's going to speak on teen pregnancy. And the only requirement is that if you don't have a game on that Friday, you still got to come to attend this meeting to hear these speakers. That's the only thing we'll require. It's not going to cost the city a whole lot, but it's going to cost a little lot. I didn't realize when I started this that we was going to get into a lot of cost. I thought we could just start it and keep right going, but then I found out, you know, it's getting so large, we got to have some people to work. And I didn't realize that. There's a lot that I'm learning now that I didn't know at first, because it's getting to the point that it's going to be larger than I thought. And now I'm praying that this be a yearly event, that we just don't have this one time. I'm focusing on the age group from 12 to 17. And that way we'll have people coming in every year as people graduate every year. We already have uniforms. We feel like we may have to buy enough uniform for two more teams, because we're going to have so many kids. We anticipate at least 100. So far we have 80. And we are extending it. We going to the county, but not to Eden, Madison. We want to pick up Rockingham. And so we bringing over them, because we found out this year most of the kids that signed up to join this program was from Rockingham County. So we're picking up a lot of kids from the county. So we want to stay with that group. And we are focusing on Rockingham girls and Reidsville girls to start the girls league. I've already talked with some coaches. We already got a lot of things in place. But the time limit that we was trying to do it this year was too quick. And I'm talking with Michael Pierce and Tom, they talked with me, and we agreed that let's wait till next year, and that way we'll have it more organized, because we have had this program, if some of you remember, in the past. It didn't last. Well, doing my research in it, I found out that it didn't have no structure to it. That's why it didn't last. We're going to have a team concept, so people are going to come and support their team. And I know when you're on a team, you're going to want to come and support your team. So it will be very structured. I'm not worrying about law enforcement. I've been over there working this whole year. The kids have come to respect me, and we have no problem with discipline, because they know I play up no nonsense. One strike and you got to go away from the gym for a while. They realize that now. I got a lot of respect out of these young people. I'm learning a lot from Mr. Gordon Slade, who did this for years. He's just getting a little slow now. He's up in age, but he's a good mentor to tell me how to get things done. And in the future, I'm going to be coming out into the community and ask for donations. I've already got quite a few. I got about $1,600-$1,700 in donations already from citizens of your region. And I'm going to try to start a program to come to business and see can business help sponsor this as, what did we call this last night?
Like a wall.
Like a sponsor. And everybody that sponsored our business, we're going to put a banner up on the wall to let people know that they sponsored. Help sponsor this thing, this tournament, this team concept thing. And I wish I had my proposal in front of me so I could really show you how it was, but I think I'm giving you a good example. The main thing that the problem was that it didn't have structure. This one is going to have structure and some order, and it's going to last. I know it's going to last for a while. Like I said again, we talked about this, and we tabled it for another year. And the citizens, I have just let them know that we can't do it this year because it started so late. But we are going to try to get it done next year. And the way we're going to do it, I'm praying that they work with me. We already have a team lead that starts in March. We're going to just kick that back 3 months. When school get out, we're going to give them a week, because when everybody got out of school, they go to the beach. We're going to give a chance to go to the beach that 1 week, and we'll start it next week. And we're going to end it 2 weeks before football season, so we won't fall over into the school project. It's been well planned. A lot of work that went in by me setting up at night, and a lot of phone calls from other people helping me out. I'm just excited that we can get this going next year. I got a whole year to try to get it going. And if anybody here on the council, anybody in the city, have anything they want to inject into this program, feel free to call me. My number's in the phone book, and I'm always around town. I be over at the gym about every day. Feel free to come and tell me what may work and may not work. I'm open for suggestions. I'm not a one-minded person. I got an open mind, and I'll listen to what anybody has to say. So please, if you can help me, I appreciate the help. Thank you. I didn't didn't think I was going to get into it that long.
Well, thank you, Reverend Watson. It sounds like you've done a lot of work. So we welcome to have the time. Appreciate it. Godspeed to you. That concludes the council members' report. Now we'll get back on the agenda, and at this time, we will open it up for public comment. Anyone in the audience who wishes to address the city council, you're free to come forward and do it so at this time. We ask that you respect the time limit, which is 5 minutes. So if you need to address the city council, please come forward. 3 minutes, I'm sorry. 3 minutes. Queen, you got me on the long line. 3 minutes. 3 minutes. If anyone would like to speak for 3 minutes, you're welcome to come back. I'll come. Seeing now, we will close that public comment. This time, the city manager's report. And I thought it was interesting, the city manager's wife was here for a good portion of my meeting. Time you to speak, she left.
Yeah. We hadn't seen she had been in the way for several days. So just driving by, stop to see what I do.
That's sweet.
Yeah, that'll be in the minutes.
Make sure you put that in there.
Strike that.
My report, I hope you all had an opportunity. I really don't, these are informational things that I had in there for you, all these items I had in there. So any of these that you would like to discuss further with me, I'd be glad to. One thing that I did want to talk about was, I'd asked you all in a memo-wise fact to you, was that that we bring your calendar so we can look at a date for my annual review, my appraisal. It was due in June, and June is leaving us really fast, and we just haven't been able to find the time in June for us all to get together. It is important, I think, for all of us, for me to meet with all the city council. So the first available dates I have in July would be the 5th and 6th of July. I'm anticipating that what we would do is meet about start about 9, hopefully not take more than 2 hours to talk about what I've been doing and what I can improve on.
Any council member have a conflict on Thursday, July the 5th at 9 o'clock?
I do.
You do?
Mm-hmm. All right. And the 6th.
And the 6th. So both that, is it any time of those days are out of total?
All of them, it's all out.
All right, Mike, I guess, how about the next week, Mike? Can you?
The next week, it will be.
The 9th, starting on the 9th.
Starting on the 9th, I'm available in the morning on the Monday, the 9th, the 10th, or the 11th or the 13th.
9th, 10th, 11th, any of those are good.
Does anyone have a conflict on the 9th? Any conflict on the 9th at 9 o'clock?
Mayor, I've been called for jury duty on that day. I hope to get out of it.
Is that the first, that's the first week of criminal court?
Yes, sir.
First week, so you'll have to be there.
We'll be up.
So is that the whole week for you, or?
I don't know. I have to be there on Monday.
The week of the 16th?
Let me just, before we go past that, my experience in court, and that captain was verified. They normally break down. They definitely don't have a court spirit going on Friday. It'd be really,
that's
really,
right.
Really, really, really unusual for Friday.
That's
and
right.
Most times judges quit on Wednesday.
That's true.
So, but you'd probably be okay on Thursday, but
Thursday would be good for me, but Friday would be.
Friday would be good.
Friday the 13th
for my appraisal.
Amen.
It's a good idea.
Does anybody have any conflict on Friday the 13th?
No.
All right. Wait a minute. I got a grand baby birthday, but I tell you what, I don't know. Let's go ahead and put it down. If I can't, I can't. Because it's getting too late.
You're not
going to
be doing it in the morning.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can.
Yeah.
Wait a minute. I'm going to be out. I will not.
Okay.
That's right. Let's
How about the afternoon of the 12th? Are you going to be gone that whole week, Mayor?
I think so.
Okay.
Yeah,
let's keep going.
The 16th.
16th.
Okay, I think. Anybody, how about 9 o'clock on the 16th?
Everybody's good.
Just go ahead and put that in, 9 o'clock on the 16th.
Quickly. Okay, sounds great. Very good, that's all I have here.
Okay. Thank you, Mike. Clark, I know you're anxious to get that done. Just over that is a problem. I'm still concerned about this date. Announcement of boards and commissions appointments.
Okay, there was one appointment being considered, and that was for Pat Morgan of 1607 Portland Avenue for the Reidsville Human Relations Commission. It was unanimous to reinstate him to that board.
Congratulations, Judge Morgan. Next item is closed session pursuant to General Statute 143-318.1. 11A to 5 to discuss property acquisition. I need a motion for this. We're going to close that. Do that motion.
So moved.
Motion by Councilman Turner. Don't go looking down there, Mr. Gore.
Second.
Second by Councilman Gore. Those two have been hitting all of them. Okay, all those in favor, please, and get ready to write in.